Plainly, one of the most important people to understand in theological culture in general, but even more so in Reformed and Presbyterian and Reformed Baptist theology, is Cornelius Van Til. And today we have one of the world's foremost experts on Cornelius Van Til, a man that really understands him from the bottom up, professor of apologetics and systematic theology at Westminster Theological Seminary, K. Scott Oliphint. He's a graduate of West Texas State University, BA and MAR and PhD in 1994, and ordained minister in the Orthodox Presbyterian Church. Dr. Oliphint served in pastoral ministry in Texas before coming to Westminster in 1991. He's the author of numerous books and articles, including The Battle Belongs to the Lord, The Power of Scripture for Defending Our Faith, Reasons for Faith, Revelation and Reason, Epistemology and Christian Belief, Westminster Theological Journal, Fall 2001, Something Much to Say, Too Plain to Say, Westminster Theological Journal, Fall 2006. Please help me welcome Pastor Scott Oliphint.
Thank you, Chris. Thanks to those of you who remain. This is the infallible proof. We're talking about proofs. This is the infallible proof of the fifth point of Calvinism. Perseverance of the saints. You've done it after this. Well, it's been a joy to be here and to listen to the various scholars discuss various aspects of apologetics and Christian theology, especially Reformed theology. I've been given the task of trying to explain and help you understand my mentor, Dr. Cornelius Van Til, in an hour. So I had to be selective, and I hope this doesn't require another seminar entitled Understanding Dr. Van Til. So I hope this isn't as opaque as a Van Til can be. Sometimes the Apostle Peter said about Paul, there are some things hard to understand. And anybody who's read Van Til knows that to be the case as well. Some things in Van Til hard to understand. Just a sampling. This is a random sampling of some things Dr. Van Til wrote. The only way we can meet the position of modern science is by pointing out that the non-theistic probability notion, whether of the subjective or of the objective kind, reduces experience to nonsense. Such a notion is based upon a philosophy of chance, and a philosophy of chance is the opposite of a philosophy of rationality. There can be no causality, and there can be no computation of statistical averages except upon the presupposition of God as creator and redeemer of the universe. The God of Christianity has a purpose with the universe. For that reason, there is purpose within the universe. A true immanentistic teleology requires a transcendent teleology. Understood? Sure. Or, after discussing Hegelian idealism, Van Til says, on an idealistic basis, there can in reality be no free human nature, for all are but moments in the infinite free necessity. Nor can there be any adequate conception of a personal God to whom we are responsible, for we are a part of God who is still in the making. With evil thus reduced to metaphysical necessity, responsibility and freedom is destroyed. God and we are ultimately one. Crime, the perpetrator, and the judge are identified. The court can be dismissed. There is no cause for action. God is to be his own theodicy, but why should he justify himself to himself? For it is his very nature that must objectify itself through a process of finitude and evil. Understandable. All right, you get that. Or he said, in the same context, according to theism, the relation of the human mind to the objects of the physical universe is mediated through the plan of God. It is then impossible to let the whole truth or falsity of the knowledge of facts beyond the human mind depend upon the so-called subjectivity or objectivity of the universals. To say that knowledge of the categories of thought is to knowledge of objective facts is uncertain or untrustworthy because the human mind contributes the categories of thought is to deny, even if it be only indirectly, the plan of God according to which all facts are related. Or on the medieval scholastic view of evil, Van Til says the scholastic idea is that all being is as being good. Hence, if there were to be an absolutely evil will in man, he would have no more being at all. This necessity of being simultaneously good and evil is only one side of the picture. It is the Parmenidean principle of identity by which all the facts of the space-time world must be rationally related. The other side of the picture is the Heraclitian principle of diversity. According to this principle, God and man participate in pure contingency, and because of this, both are free. God and man are, therefore, on this view, both wholly determined and wholly undetermined. All right, simple enough. Those don't need explanation. You don't need to have any understanding of those kinds of things. I'm just kidding. Just a short personal, if you'll indulge me a minute, short personal story about how I got involved in these things. I'll give you the short story instead of the long one. In 1977, Christianity Today published their magazine in December with a picture on the front. And the title was "The Legacy of a Down-to-Earth Scholar." It had a picture of Van Til on it. And I remember getting that in my mailbox, and I grabbed the magazine, and I was interested at that point in apologetics. I was taking philosophy at college and had read a good bit of Francis Schaeffer's work, and so I thought, well, this might be interesting. So it was a question and answer with Van Til. And in one of the little boxes, description of who Van Til was, it said Cornelius Van Til has taught such luminaries as E.J. Carnell and Francis Schaeffer and others that were on the list. And I thought, well, okay, I've read Schaeffer. Might be a good idea to read the teacher of Schaeffer. So I went down to the bookstore. For some of you youngsters, that's a store where they used to have physical things with print inside, and they called those books. So I went down to the bookstore, and I asked the local bookstore, I said, I need a copy of this book, Defense of the Faith by Cornelius Van Til. And he pulled out this massive book. Some of you will know what it is, Books in Print. Remember that is massive tome. Bookstores and libraries have books in print. So he just goes thumbing through. And he said, oh, yeah, okay, that's right. He said, that'll be a month. We'll have it in a month. All right, so no Amazon, no internet. So I waited and waited, and I began as a college student to read Defense of the Faith in the middle of the Texas Panhandle with no one there to help. And I was reading this material, and I was thinking, oh, my goodness, this is kind of difficult. So I took some of the quotations to my philosophy professor, who was a Christian man, influential in my life, and we would take time after philosophy class, and I'd say, okay, here's the quote. And he would read the quote, and he would say, I have no idea what that means. So I'd bring him in and say, here's what he says. What does he mean? He said, I don't know. I don't know what he means. So I was, again, sort of on my own, and at the back of this book that I had ordered, Defense of the Faith, that was listed Westminster Seminary, P.O. Box 27009, Philadelphia, PA 19118, gave the address of the seminary. So I wrote the seminary, and I said, I'm kind of out here in Texas struggling with some of this. Is there anybody there that could help me with some of these terms and ideas and concepts? And they wrote back and said, here's Van Til's home address. Just drop him a note. 16 Rich Avenue. That was his home. So I write, Dr. Cornelius Van Til, 16 Rich Avenue. You know, I'm just a dumb college kid. I don't know where to go on this. So I just write him a letter. And I say, you know, you say this on page such and such, and I'm not sure what you mean. And I didn't know if I'd get an answer or not. It turned out this. So we started corresponding, and it turned out a week to the day that I would send the questions would come his response. In a small envelope, folded up spiral pages written in ink. He had this spiral he'd write in. So he'd get my letter, and he would write in his spiral, and he'd finish it. He'd tear out, you know, 8, 10, sometimes 12 pages, fold them up in his little envelope, cram them in, and write it back, right back to me, Scott Oliphint. And I would read those things just salivating. So I'd refer to the page, refer to this. So eventually that became so useful to me that I thought, well, let's see if he'll come down to this little town in Texas and help us out. So I wrote him and I said, I know, you know, you're retired, but you may not want to travel this far. Would you be interested? And he said, I'd love to come. So he came down to Texas and stayed with us in our home for a few days. And he said, here's the condition. You're going to have to take a walk with me every day, because I walk every day. I said, no problem. Guy's in his 80s. I want to tell you what, we were picking him up and putting him down, and he would walk 2 miles every day and at a quick pace. He was still a pretty vigorous Dutchman at that point, and I was just pumping him with questions. And I dearly wish I had one of these little devices, you know, where I could have turned on the recorder. Because he would intersperse stories about Machen and what Machen has said, what Machen did, and oh, by the way, and off he'd go in his theology again. He was just a remarkable man, and I remember asking him one time about Gordon Clark. I don't know why this goes off, but I'm smart enough to fix it. Hey, huh? Has nothing to do with smarts. I asked him about Gordon Clark, the Clark debate. We'll talk about that in just a minute. I planned to speak about this before I knew everything else was going to be said. But I said, tell me about Clark. First thing Van Til said, I pray for that man every day. He's a dear philosopher, much better philosopher than I ever was. And when he said he prays for him every day, he prays for him every day. So just to say, there are different views on how all of that should have fallen out. But my introduction to Van Til was with the man himself. And when I decided to go to Westminster Seminary, I wrote him and I said, I've got to go to seminary. I need more of this. And he said, well, you'll stay with me then and just use my car and you can look for housing using my car. So I stayed with him and he said, you know the condition, don't you? And I said, yeah, we have to take your walks every day. So we would take his walk and he would introduce me to his neighbors and almost every neighbor. And this is not an exaggeration because I got it time and time and to the point where I was thinking, this is it. And this is what he did. Almost every neighbor said, I guess he's talking to you about Jesus too, isn't he? Every neighbor knew what Dr. Van Til believed. Just a dear, gracious, hospitable man. Not a combatant in personality, but not giving an inch theologically. That's the man I knew. So he recognized in himself, Van Til wrote in one of his journals, he was frustrated by his inability to communicate as clearly as he wanted to. He knew that in himself. He couldn't, you know, he got to a point where he couldn't figure out the reason, and he wrote in one of his journals, he said, I wish I could be as clear as Machen. Christian liberalism, just so clear about the divide between Christianity and the liberals in theology. But he was frustrated that he couldn't do it. I have my own theories on that. I think what Van Til didn't get, and there are numerous reasons why he might not have got, what he didn't get was the rest of the world was not as smart as he was. He thought we all were where he was. And so when he began to write his apologetic syllabuses and some of his books, he assumed that you and I had as much biblical and theological background as he had so that he could just launch into his apologetic. And the problem is we didn't and we don't. He was raised on the Bible, read every day at every meal in his Dutch home before he moved here at the age of 10. Raised on the Bible, read theology by the time he went to study at Calvin. He had read Kuyper, he had read Bavinck. He knew these men backwards and forwards. Then he's off to Princeton, and he's studying under the Princetonians who had learned from Warfield, including Machen, and had a tremendous mind and capability to grasp these things. So what Van Til did when he began to think about apologetics as he studied philosophy at Princeton University, and particularly studied idealism, what he began to do was to take Christianity and show that what idealism wants, only Christianity has. But he wanted to do that in a way that communicated with the idealistic philosophers. So he communicated in their language. And that's part of the problem. Especially today when idealism is not known very much, the language has changed. And even in his day, because idealism was so ambiguous in so much of what it said, like all continental philosophy is, most philosophy is, just ambiguous. So he was trying to communicate things apologetically to idealist philosophers, some of whom were saying idealism is Christianity in philosophical garb. It just is a Christian philosophy. Some were saying that. But others were saying we don't need Christianity because idealism provides the absolute that we need in order to make sense of life. And Van Til said no. So he wrote his dissertation on idealism and on pragmatism. Pragmatism. Does that sound like Van Til? You think about Van Til, oh, he's an expert in pragmatism. What he showed in his dissertation is that the foundations for both are the same. Nobody was saying that at that point. The foundations for idealism and pragmatism are the same, and they cannot justify their own basic position. That's what Van Til said. He was right about that. So one of the things Van Til says in his discussion of idealism is the notion, here's Van Til now, the notion of the concrete universal has been offered by idealist philosophy in order to escape the reductio ad absurdum of the abstract particular and the abstract universal. It is only in the Christian doctrine of the triune God, as we are bound to believe, that we really have a concrete universal. In God's being, there are no particulars not related to the universal, and there's nothing universal that is not fully expressed in the particulars. Now, most of the world won't understand what that means. Van Til recognizes that. But idealist philosophers will, because a concrete universal was a Hegelian idea in opposition to Kantians, neo-Kantians, who thought of a universal as an abstract thing out there that can't be applied in any way to historical phenomena. Hegel says, and the Hegelians said, the universal's got to be concrete. It's got to be in history, but it also has to transcend history. Van Til says, if that's what you want, folks, if you want an absolute, a universal, that's in history, even while it transcends history, you're not going to get it with a Hegelian notion of an absolute. Hegel didn't even know what it was. You're only going to get it in Christianity. If that's what you want, here's how you get it. You won't get it in your own philosophy. And he speaks in those terms because he's talking to those people. And he's trying to teach at the seminary ministers of the gospel who are going to be influenced by people who come into their church and who say, idealism seems to me to be Christian. Van Til is teaching them why it isn't Christian, why the absolute of idealism is, as a matter of fact, not absolute at all. He goes on here, for the idealist logicians, the term eternity really does not mean any more than a permanent aspect of temporal beings. Bosanquet, one of the men he studied, speaks of this when he says that reality is an eternal novelty. The nature of our a posteriori differs from the idealist notion of the a posteriori, that is, the empirical. Our facts are created and controlled by God, while the facts of idealism are not. The difference lies just here, that for the idealist, the system of reference is found in the universe, inclusive of God and man, while for us, the point of reference is found in God alone. Now, you may not know what that means. It's okay if you don't. But the philosophers know what that means. And what it means is, if you want something that explains, something absolute that explains the contingency of the world and the relativity of the world and the relativism of the world, you're not going to get it in your own philosophy, because the only way the absolute is defined is by the relative. The absolute needs the relative as much as the relative needs the absolute in terms of the definition, so it's all contained within one universe. How is that absolute? Because by definition, an absolute is not supposed to be dependent. You want that kind of absolute, Van Til says, only the triune God is that kind of absolute. That's his point. That's his point. All right, so you're thinking, you're supposed to help me understand Van Til. I'm lost. Well, I want to give you three ways, I think, that it might be helpful to begin to think about Van Til. You mind if I take this off? Typically, I don't do that, but it's warm. It's California, not Philadelphia. Here's the way to do it. And I think this is the way I've tried to help my students understand, and this would be helpful for you if you're interested in reading Van Til, which you ought to be. If you're not, it's a sanctification problem. When you're reading Van Til, and you're not sure what he's saying, think about it this way. Ask yourself this question. What Reformed theological truth is Van Til explaining here? What Reformed theological truth is Van Til explaining here? If you can begin to frame your thoughts that way when you're reading something that seems completely obscure and opaque to you, ask yourself, what Reformed truth is there that he's communicating to these philosophers? Then you'll begin to get at what he's up to. He thought we all would understand what that truth is, but it's not obvious on the surface of it sometimes. So I want to try to help us understand Van Til with three basic categories. And the first one is analogical knowledge. Now, again, I just want to reiterate, I prepared this before I'd heard anyone else, but that's the providence of God. So I have the opportunity to at least give you another perspective, the true one, on the Clark Van Til discussion. Let me first say this to those of you like me who are in the OPC. The problem in the complaint, there was a complaint. You know how presbyteries work, some of you. If there's something going on with a person who's come up for ordination and he's being approved to be ordained, people in the presbytery, ministers in the presbytery, can file a complaint which basically says we want to pursue this more. We think there might be some issues here, so we want to pursue this. It's a complaint. The complaint was filed by John Murray and Ned Stonehouse before Van Til ever got involved in the discussions. That doesn't mean he had no influence, but he wasn't involved in the writing of the complaint, contrary to popular belief. The complaint was denied by the presbytery. They said, we hear your concerns, Mr. Murray and Stonehouse, we hear your concerns, but we don't think that they're serious enough at this point to warrant not proceeding with ordination. So they denied the complaint. Clark was exonerated. I remember walking with Ed Clowney one day. Ed Clowney was the first president of Westminster Seminary, and he was president from, I think, 53 to 83, something like that. I remember walking with Dr. Clowney, and I said, I'm just curious what you thought about the Clark debate, because he was there. And he said it had to happen. It needed to be discussed. And he said, I just wish Clark had stayed. So what happened, even though Clark was exonerated, he was mad enough so that he left. So again, contrary to some of the discussion that's been had, it was not the case that there was just this boom, boom, boom. It was, Clark, you're okay for ordination. Clark said, I don't want it, I'm leaving. And he left. Okay, so it was a significant discussion, and I think, I agree with Dr. Clowney, I think it had to happen. I don't think, as has been written, that it was a low point in our denomination. That doesn't mean, whenever these things are discussed, of course there are going to be issues in hindsight. You can say, well, I wish that and wish this, but it wasn't a low point. It needed to be discussed because the stakes were high. In my view, Clark's life showed why the stakes were high. All right, so Van Til then began to talk about analogical knowledge. Now again, why did he do that? He didn't do that because he consulted a philosophical dictionary or any other dictionary and said, I'm going to use it in a different way, and so I'm just going to do it. The only reason he did that, please hear me on this, is because that's what Bavinck said about the relationship of God's knowledge to man's knowledge. And the reason Bavinck said it is because that's what Thomas Aquinas argued. There was a long hundreds of years tradition of the use of analogy with respect to the relationship of God to the creature in theology that was already set out and defined in a particular way. Van Til was not saying anything new in his use of analogy. Murray and Stonehouse understood that view, and that's why they filed the complaint. Clark's view was new. They were upholding what was the standard, typical Reformed tradition. When you think about analogical knowledge, this was brought up earlier, you have to think about it, first of all, in terms of what is called God's archetypal knowledge. So what does Van Til mean by analogical? We're going to get to that. We've got to get to that this way. First of all, there's God's archetypal knowledge. Archetypal knowledge is God's knowledge that is identical. This is so important, please. God's knowledge that is identical with his being. Because God doesn't acquire knowledge. God is not in the process of the acquisition of knowledge. As a matter of fact, again, contrary to some things that have been said, God doesn't even know propositionally. And again, that's embedded in the Reformed tradition. Turton says he knows dianoetically. That is, he sees because he is the one who sees. His being and his knowledge are identical. You know what that means? If you have that archetypal knowledge yourself at any point, at that point, that knowledge is identical with the being of God. And the Reformed have steadfastly maintained you can't have that because that's God's and God's alone because it's identical with his being and his character. When you look at the history of the Reformation and you see some of the men who were trained in Thomism, that is in the philosophical theology of Thomas Aquinas, and who become Reformed, one of the first things they reject is Thomas's view of analogy, because in Thomas's view of analogy, there is an identity of being even though there is a diversity of essence. Now, that's maybe too complicated to pursue at this point. But it's important to see the reason it's rejected by the Reformed is because they knew there could be no identical point, no identical thing, be it concept or anything else, between God as God and the creature. This was established early on in the history of the church. There's nothing new here. Bovink uses Thomas's word. Van Til picks up that word. The use of it has already been given for hundreds of years in the church. So you have God's archetypal knowledge. Now, here's an interesting point, I think. What the Reformed would say then is that, well, if God's archetypal knowledge is identical with his being, and yet we know God, what kind of knowledge is it that we have when we say we know God truly? And the Reformed would say, and this comes primarily from Franciscus Junius, Reformed scholastic, Junius says, well, what we have is ectypal knowledge. But notice, it's first of all God's ectypal. So it's from the type which flows from God's archetypal knowledge. Reformed theologians have discussed this in various ways. Some talk about God's necessary knowledge and his free knowledge, his necessary will and his free will. We have to make distinctions like that theologically because we know creation is not necessary. God didn't have to create. It's contingency. So those things that refer to the contingent are free with respect to God's knowledge. So we're talking about knowledge that is identical with God's being, and then from that comes knowledge that God will communicate to us, our ectypal knowledge. And our ectypal knowledge flows from God's ectypal knowledge. That is, again, we have to think of this woodenly. We're trying to make sense of what revelation is. It's not identical with the being of God, but it communicates truly because it's God saying it. God says, this is what I will say in revealing myself. And as Calvin says, then he begins to lisp to us. He talks baby talk. It's like you do with, like I do with my grandkids. You get down and you don't want anybody to see this. You don't want a camera rolling because you begin to speak on a level that nobody would want to understand or could understand. But you get down at that level to say, is it funny? Is it? You know, you do that sort of thing or something like it, which could be meaningless. But what are you doing? You're trying to talk on that level. That's Calvin's image of what God does when he's communicating, revealing himself to us. All of it flows from his archetypal. All of it is from God, therefore true. But the notion of analogical knowledge in the Reformed view is a rejection of any coincidence, yeah, that's a good word, coincidence between the being of God and thus the knowledge of God and the being of man and thus the knowledge of man. Creator, creature, at the beginning of our understanding of knowledge. All right? And that's been a basic theological truth. And I think we have to hold to it. So we have God's archetypal, God's ectypal, from God's ectypal, our ectypal, which is then relational knowledge. In other words, it's God covenantally relating to us and therefore revealing to us. And that revelation, as you know, has two modes. What's the first mode? Anyone? It's trying to keep you awake. Thank you. Natural. The mode is what? Through creation. And what happens when God reveals himself in and through all of creation? What happens to creatures made in his image? Why are we guilty? Just because God reveals, we're guilty? Absolutely. Because we know him. You know how we know him? Through creation. So I just want to put a warning into all of those discussions that talk about knowledge having to be necessarily propositional. Not with God, it doesn't. He reveals through creation, and he makes sure people know him, even if at no point in their mind do they say, I know God. So God speaks. You know how Psalm 19 puts it? The heavens what? Declare. The language is speech language. Day to day pours forth speech. Night to night reveals knowledge. This is God speaking through creation. You can communicate without a word, can't you? Those of you who are married know about this. I've heard, I don't know from experience, my wife can testify, I've heard that there are such things as marital arguments. I don't know about that. I mean, but I've also heard that in those kinds of arguments, one of the people in the argument might do something like this. All right? Or, am I communicating? Yeah, if you've been in those, you know that. You can communicate without a word. So we need to move away from this, I think, overly rationalistic dependence on nothing but propositions and recognize that God's communication takes the form of creation and then takes the form of his speech, special revelation. And both are meant to go together. They haven't gone together since we created the divide because of sin, but they're meant to go together so that now we only understand the natural through the special, in acknowledging what it says. But God's knowledge gets through, and that knowledge is God's revelation. So when it comes to the term analogical, all right, again, I just want to make clear here, that is a traditional theological term that is used in a host of theological texts and defined in various ways there. Bovink used it. Van Til had read Bovink from cover to cover. He used it because Bovink did, but he tweaked the meaning a little bit. We don't need to get into details of that, but he helped us understand that analogical means ectypal. It means from God knowledge. It's from God knowledge. What makes it true? God reveals it, and God reveals it in reference to what God has made into himself. It's true. It's God revealing. It refers to creation. It refers to God. All right, so maybe that'll help you. Now, I won't bore you with that. The second thing I want us to think about for a minute, it was brought up earlier in the earlier discussion, is Van Til's transcendental method. All right, so here's what he says about it. He says, we've already indicated that the Christian method uses neither the inductive nor the deductive method as understood by the opponents of Christianity, but that it has elements of both induction and of deduction in it if these terms are understood in a Christian sense. Now, when these two elements are combined, we have what is meant by a truly transcendental argument. A truly transcendental argument takes any fact of experience which it wishes to investigate and tries to determine what the presuppositions of such a fact must be in order to make it what it is. Okay, that was discussed earlier, helpfully, I think, in the way that Van Til uses it. As was said earlier, it's a notion that he got from Immanuel Kant. Van Til is studying idealism. He's reading through Kant. He's a Reformed Christian. He reads Kant's idea that instead of empiricism, instead of rationalism, both of which failed, by the way, can we just make note of that, that the history of philosophy has been an abysmal failure? Can we just make note of that? They've made no progress in 4,000 years. That's important. But Kant was saying not empiricism, not rationalism, but what? What I need to do, he was saying, instead of Hume's way, which wound up in skepticism, he was influenced by Hume, but he knew that Hume's view was wound up with pure skepticism. He said, what I need to do then is take what is given, here's a fact, and then ask the question, what are the presuppositions behind that fact and which make that fact possible? Because Hume had convinced some that we couldn't depend on things like cause and effect. He uses the illustration of the billiard ball. He said, we can't depend on that. Empiricism won't give you the reality of cause and effect, so we have to dismiss the notion. Then Hume says, by the way, I go outside my study and I play backgammon, which of course I can do, but has nothing to do with my philosophy. Then I go back in and do my philosophy. So even Hume admitted it. You know, this doesn't make sense, but what else can I do? I'm a radical empiricist. And Kant said, this can't work. How do we think about cause and effect? Well, for Kant, there were categories of the mind that were imposed on objective reality, which was otherwise chaotic, so that we, in effect, were creating our own world by these categories imposed on the data of our experience. Van Til's reading along in this, and he says, wait a minute. That's a good question and a horrible answer. That's a good question. Given any fact, what are the presuppositions behind that fact and which make it possible? And that's what Bonson was doing in his debate, as was described earlier so well. That's why he was so good at it. He knew what that meant. Given any fact, logic, science, morality, what are the presuppositions behind that and which make it possible? What are they? So, for example, in The New Atheist, some of you may know, maybe you don't. We had Christopher Hitchens on our campus at one point and had a chance to chat with him a little bit. And one of the questions that was asked of Christopher Hitchens, you know, his book, God is Not Great. Don't ever write a book like that. Just some advice, pastoral advice, with that title, God is Not Great. But what's the subtitle? How Religion Poisons Everything. It's from an atheist. So the question came to Hitchens, what's wrong with poisoning everything? Why is that so bad? Given the poisoning of religion, the question then, the transcendental question is, what are the presuppositions behind that that make that so bad? Why is that a bad thing? I mean, religion poisons religious people, and according to Hitchens, religious people ought to all be destroyed. Hitchens and I had this long discussion on the way back. It's funny, a limo pulled up to pick him up to take him back to our campus, and he goes, no, I want to ride with him. So he and I rode in the car together, and he was telling me that he was extolling the glories of the Iraq War. All these religious people getting killed, it's just great. So what's wrong with poisoning everything? What are the presuppositions behind that fact and which make it possible? All right, Van Til goes on to say, an exclusively deductive argument would take an axiom such as that every cause must have an effect and reason in a straight line from such an axiom, drawing all manner of conclusions about God and man. A purely inductive argument would begin with any fact and seek in a straight line for a cause of such an effect, and thus perhaps conclude that this universe must have had a cause. Both of these methods have been used for the defense of Christianity. Yet neither of them could be thoroughly Christian unless they already presupposed God. Any method that does not maintain that not a single fact can be known unless it be that God gives that fact meaning is an anti-Christian method. On the other hand, if God is recognized as the only and the final explanation of any and every fact, neither the inductive nor the deductive method can any longer be used to the exclusion of the other. Induction, fine. Deduction, fine. As long as we recognize that every fact in God's world is first of all God's fact, God's the one that gives it meaning. You saw the quotes from Nagel and a couple of philosophers talking about brute facts. Van Til, just over and over again, there are no brute facts. Why not? I remember reading a postmodern about 10 years ago. He said, I like Van Til. There are no brute facts because we interpret all those facts. So they all have our interpretation. He turned it into a Kantian of all things. Immanuel Kant. We just interpret those facts. That's what Van Til means. That's not what he means. God interprets those facts and says, let there be and there is. And every fact has its final reference point in the God who created and sustains it. No brute facts. Every fact screams the existence of God. And every person involved in that fact knows the God who's revealed in it and says, I will have none of it unless the grace of God changes that hard heart. I will have none of it. But they know. They know. So Van Til was adamant, I think helpfully adamant, that this kind of approach, the transcendental approach to the existence of God, is a Christian approach. It's a Reformed Christian approach. Ask it this way. When Van Til's talking about the transcendental method, given any fact or the presupposition behind it make it possible, what's he saying? Here's what he's saying. Let me try to say it to you this way. He's saying Christianity is true. You believe that if you're a Christian? You believe that, don't you? Now, here's what we've been trained to believe almost subtly sometimes. We don't understand that that's what we're actually thinking, but we might be thinking this way. What that means is Christianity is true to me because I believe it. And that's the way I see the world, right? Is that what we mean when we say Christianity is true? It's part of it. I mean, it's true and I believe it, but it's true whether or not I believe it. Isn't it? And when we say it's true, it means that Christianity, that is the revelation of God, Genesis to Revelation, interprets reality for us and interprets who God is for us because God is the one revealing. That means Christianity alone tells us what the world is and who we are and who God is. Only in Christianity. And guess what else that means? That means any other position that opposes Christianity is what? What? False. Yeah. And you know what that means? That doesn't just mean that people have false propositions in their minds. That's the way we say, that's false. That means you don't believe that. No, it means that people can't live it and think it consistently. Can't be done because they're creatures made in the image of God living in God's world saying there is no God and I'm not his creature. You can't live that consistently. You can't think that consistently. So what do? Borrowed capital. You take stuff from Christianity and import it into your system. It's a foreign organ into a body that won't take it and it will be rejected by that system because there's no consistency in that. And that's what Van Til wanted these philosophers to try to understand. You can't have an absolute because God alone, the triune God, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, he's the only absolute who works in history and transcends history. And you give me something better, you idealist philosophers. And here's what you're not going to do. You're not going to be able to go to empiricism because it's failed. And you can't go to rationalism because it's failed. And you can't go to Kant who tried to combine them both because he's failed. Where are you going to go? That's the impossibility of the contrary. Philosophy's failed and failed and failed and failed. And what do they say? Back to the drawing board. Here we go again. I've got a PhD. I can handle this. I'll solve the problem of the universe. And off they go, writing their books. Van Til says, no, nope. You bow the knee with your PhD. And that's how you understand what the world is like. You start with God. That's how you understand. Amen. Thank you. Surely you're not Presbyterian. Here's what Van Til says. What does he mean by presuppose? This is where some things can get confusing for some people. What's my time? quarter six. He says, how then, we ask, is the Christian to challenge this non-Christian approach to the interpretation of human experience? How does the Christian challenge the non-Christian approach? Here's how. There's so much packed in here. I spend a long time with my students with this one paragraph, but let me see if I can just break it down a little bit. He says, he can do so only if he shows that man must presuppose God as the final reference point in predication. Otherwise, he would destroy experience itself. He can do so only if he shows the non-Christian that even in his virtual negation of God, he is still really presupposing God. He can do so only if he shows the non-Christian that he cannot deny God unless he first affirm him, and that his own approach throughout its history has been shown to be destructive of human experience itself. There is so much loaded into that. But notice how he uses the idea of presuppose. What does it mean? That's why I have the question mark. What does it mean by presuppose? Good question. I'm glad you asked. First thing he says, he can do so only if he shows that man must presuppose God, notice, as the final reference point in predication. That phrase, final reference point, in other words, where does all of this go? All right, we saw the quote in the last presentation of the physicist who says, you know, the laws, they just are. Are you going to live with that? I was speaking to a group of college students years ago in a Christian context. I was invited by Christian ministry at this college, and I was speaking on God being the creator of the universe and all what that means in terms of God's revelation. And at the end of it, there was a man who came up to me afterwards, an older gentleman, and he said, I just wanted to say hello. He said, I'm a physics professor here at the university. I wanted to hear your talk. And he said, I'm an atheist. And he said, let me see if I understand what you're saying. He said, you're saying that that in my physics, in my teaching of physical laws and their constancy and everything that goes on in the world, that I have no foundation for those laws. Is that what you're saying? I said, yeah. And he goes, you're right. It got him. Because I was trying to teach it from Scripture. He understood that as an atheist. So people who know God, they may say to you, well, the laws just are because they are. But God is saying inside of them through revelation internally and externally, you know you don't believe that. You know you don't believe that. You're suppressing the truth in unrighteousness. People will build the mask, but the truth of God comes through every single time. You cannot put up a wall strong enough as an unbeliever that God's revelation can't penetrate it. At every single point that the heart beats, the revelation of God comes in. All right, so Van Til says, God must be the interpretation of human experience. Man must presuppose God. There's the obligation. What does that mean? That means the explanation of everything you are and do in life has to refer to the triune God, or it's meaningless. That's what it means. You should presuppose God that way. That's what he says. All right, then notice what he says after that. Otherwise, he would destroy experience itself. That's proven. He can do so only if he shows the non-Christian, notice this, that even in his virtual negation of God, he is still really presupposing God. And what does he mean there? He just said you got to tell him you got to presuppose, you have to presuppose God. And then you tell him, by the way, in negating God, you're presupposing God. What does that mean? I mean, the atheist is not, he's going to say, I don't presuppose God. What Van Til means there is exactly what Bonson was saying in that debate with Gordon Stein. The very fact that you're here debating with me is proof of the existence of God. Even as you deny God and assume that denial has any meaning and reference point, you can't have that unless the God that I'm talking about, who's revealed himself to us, exists. How, as an atheist, are you going to make sense of the words leaving my mouth and floating out into this chaotic environment and connecting in your ears with your mind, and now we have two minds and we're not even sure what those are, whether or not they exist, and you're saying that there's meaning in this communication when there's no God? Your negation of God is proof that God exists. That's what Van Til's saying. What's he saying? What's the Christian? What's the Reformed Christian principle here? Every person is made in the image of God, lives in God's world, and they live and move and have their being in that God, and unless that's true, they don't exist. That's what he's saying. That's the truth of it, isn't it? It's the basic principle. That's what he means. So even in the negation, The fool has said in his heart, there is no God. That has meaning, and he's a fool. See, he's a fool. All right, so there's another idea of presupposing. There he's talking about the objective situation. The non-Christian, that even in his negation of God, he's still presupposing God. He's not presupposing God in terms of his own belief system. That's why he's an unbeliever. He's presupposing God, if I can put it this way, in the kind of Kantian way that the precondition, the underlying presupposition of the negation has to be some foundation in which there's meaning in the words themselves. The subject and predicate make sense. They meet with another mind. All of these things can only happen in a world that God has made and controls and sustains. And if you say, no, I don't believe that, then you say, give me another good way to think about this. And you can't do rationalism, and you can't do empiricism, and you can't do Kantianism, and you can't do Hegelianism, and you can't do positivism. Everything's been tried. You're back at the drawing board. Now what are you going to do? What are you going to do? That's the impossibility of the contrary. There's nothing left. And then he says, he can do so only if he shows the non-Christian that he cannot deny God unless he first affirm him. Saying the same thing. The denial, if it's going to have meaning, is an affirmation. It's an affirmation because God is the creator of language. God is the creator of people. God is the covenant God who brings people, all people, into community with themselves. He orchestrates it. He providentially controls it. He alone is the explanation for the meaning of any person and any person's belief. That's what Van Til means by presuppose. All right, so I have my own definition. I'll pass over that. It's just a try. But here's what Van Til says. We must therefore give our opponents better treatment than they give us. We must point out to them that univocal reasoning itself leads to self-contradiction. This is important. Not only from a theistic point of view, but from a non-theistic point of view as well. It is this that we ought to mean when we say that we must meet our enemy on their own ground. It is this that we ought to mean when we say that we reason from the impossibility of the contrary. The contrary is impossible only if it is self-contradictory when operating on the basis of its own assumptions. So the point here is not simply, I don't agree with you atheist because I'm a Christian. I believe differently. That's obvious, right? But it's, I don't agree with you because your own system is utterly irrational. Your own way of thinking provides no foundation for me. What's wrong with poisoning everything, Mr. Hitchens? I can't find a foundation of morality that will allow me as an atheist to make that kind of judgment. Poisoning is wrong. I don't get it. So you look at the position that you're dealing with, the unbelieving position, and you recognize there's no possible way. You know this as a Christian. This is Van Til's point. There's no possible way to make sense of unbelief. Is there? Because it's false. And that's why Paul says at the end of Romans 1:20, all this revelation comes bombarding people 24 hours, 7 days a week, internally, externally, dynamically coming as God is present to reveal himself covenantally to every single individual. And they say, no, 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 I will not have it. Maybe it's aliens. Maybe it's another religion. Maybe it's Allah. Not going to have that God in my thoughts at all. And Paul says it renders every person what? Without excuse. The Greek word, anapologetus, without a defense, because unbelief is indefensible in God's world from God's creatures. It's just indefensible. Now you know that, don't you? Why is it so hard to understand Van Til? That's all he's saying. And he's saying it to idealists and to philosophers, but that's what he's telling them. The same way he would talk to his neighbors about Christ. He was talking to the idealistic philosophers about the absolute. Say, only the triune God can be absolute. All right, so that's the transcendental method approach. I like to call it approach. It's not as strictly thought about a method. You can think of it like this. Let me give you just this illustration that I've used sometimes. When we talk about a proof, oftentimes we're thinking about syllogisms. All men are mortal, first premise. Socrates is a man, second premise. Therefore what? Socrates is mortal. Now, is that a valid argument? You think that's a valid argument? What has to be the case for an argument to be valid? For a valid argument, if the premises are true, and we can talk about that later, if the premises are true, the conclusion necessarily follows. That's a valid argument. A sound argument, the premises have to be true. All right, so let's think about the premises. All men are mortal, true or false? Is it true? What? It's false? Well, okay. All men except the God man. Or more. Wait, did Jesus die? Wait, I guess he did. Yeah. See, I'm not supposed to talk about this. That's why that thing glitched. All men are mortal. No, it didn't. But how do you know it's not true? Or let me ask it this way. How do you know that it is true? Have we seen all men? Have we had experience of all men? Is there any record that maybe some man or people didn't die? Ooh, really? Is there any record that maybe some people won't die? Where is that record? So the point about the proof is, all I'm trying to say here, and it's not trying to be overly pedantic here, but all I'm trying to say is every proof has a context surrounding it. And the context is more important oftentimes than the validity or soundness of the proof, because the context helps us understand whether or not we can affirm the premises as true or false. And the transcendental approach is an attempt to get at the context, even as we're thinking about the premises. So that's why I was asking you the question, how do you know all men are mortal? You haven't experienced all men, so there's no empirical way to know it. It's not a rational point, because it has to be by definition empirical. So you're in a bind if that's all you've got. Now, again, I'm not saying to use this on people unless you want to lose friends. But the point is, there are so many things surrounding a proof, and it's those things that need our attention and discussion when we're talking about a proof. All right, last point in 3 minutes. This won't surprise some of you, but I think it's better to understand Van Til's approach as covenantal rather than presuppositional. And I'll tell you one reason. I'll tell you two reasons. One reason is years ago, 30 years ago, I was talking to a classical apologist. We happened to meet at a place, and we were talking just kind of casually and about apologetic method, things like that. And he said, are you a presuppositionalist? And I said, yeah. And he said, well, are you Clarkian or Van Tillian or Cornelian or Schaeferian? I thought, okay, that bothers me a little bit. And I started to think about why it bothered me. And then I've seen other ideas out there that talk about presuppositionalism, and it's muddy. When Van Til took this label on himself, it was given to him in an article, actually, in the 1940s. Somebody said he's presuppositionalist. Van Til's, okay, if that's what you want to talk about it. So it's not a label that he created. It's just one that kind of attached itself to him. But when that was being done in those days, people weren't talking as much about presuppositions. Since that time, it's all over the place. People are talking
a lot about presuppositions, and oftentimes without really knowing what they mean or what they are. Presuppositionalism sounds like an abstract philosophical methodology that only the PhDs can really understand or really care about. Apologetics is not for the academy, it's for the church. And Van Til knew that, and that's why he committed his life to training ministers. And that's why I think a better label is a biblical label, covenantal apologetics. And so Van Til says this: all too easily do we think of the covenant relation as quite distinct and independent of natural revelation. The two should be joined together. To speak of man's relation to God as being covenantal at every point. He's not talking about Christians here. He's talking about man, people. Is merely to say that man deals with the personal God everywhere. Every manipulation of any created fact is, as long as man is not a sinner, that is, in Christ, he doesn't mean perfect, covenant-affirming activity. Every manipulation of any fact, as soon as man is a sinner, is a covenant-breaking activity. It's all covenantally qualified. Christian or not Christian, they're still in a relationship to God. Under wrath, under grace. Those are covenantal terms. There's no other place to be in the world since the entrance of sin. And there won't be any other place to be in eternity future except under wrath or under grace. Covenantally qualified. Just two reasons, then I'll stop. Two reasons why I don't like the term presuppositionalism. And this is just, you're getting my personal thing here. I don't care if you use it. It's kind of in the literature now. But people talk about presuppositionalism versus evidentialism. So when I was asked to speak on apologetics one time, you know, the person called me and said, can I have the title of your lecture? And I said, yeah, here it is. Why I'm an evidentialist. And they said, not sure what we want. That's what we wanted when we invited you. But the point I was trying to make was, it's only in a covenantal view of who God is and what he's done that we recognize that everything evidences God. We're not opposed to evidence. We just recognize that there are people who read evidence and suppress it, and people who read evidence by the grace of God and accept it. So don't pit the two against each other. I just finished Oz Guinness's book, which I read everything Oz writes. I think he's just a fabulous writer and a brilliant intellect. And most of that book was so good. But in this one place, he says, this silly debate between presuppositionalism and evidentialism. He said, you know, it's both. Sometimes we presuppose and then there are evidences. No, that's not the point. That's the problem with presuppositionalism. It sounds like an a priori kind of commitment without evidence, you know, just sort of back here with our ideas. No, it's embedded in God's revelation in history. And everything evidences the true God. That's Paul. That's Scripture. And then there's this idea now that's been popular. Well, yeah, presupposition. Well, everyone has presuppositions, so there you go. That's not the point. That's not the point. That's why it's such a bad term. Of course, you think Van Til would spend his career teaching people everybody has presuppositions? I mean, we know that, don't we? The question is, how do we find them? How do we articulate them? What are they? Do they fit with the way the world is? Or are they irrational and incoherent? Of course, everybody has presuppositions. One more I want to say. I'll skip the Montgomery piece. But presuppositions and properly basic belief, foundationalism. There's been mention made of Alvin Plantinga. I think Alvin Plantinga has done a world of good for much in the philosophical world. But there's been much written about Alvin Plantinga and his relationship to what Van Til was teaching. Is presuppositionalism, is Van Til's approach foundationalism? And the short answer is absolutely not. Absolutely not. Properly basic belief, only in the way Plantinga articulates it, only has meaning within a common sense realistic epistemology. Van Til rejected common sense realism because it couldn't provide the foundation that needed to be provided. Only God's revelation, which tells us of who God is. Only God's revelation can do that. So there's very little. I mean, you can interweave some ways to use Plantinga's work. Somebody had mentioned his work against Darwinian naturalism, philosophical naturalism. He does a masterful job of deconstructing that. Taken, I think, somewhat from Lewis, although he doesn't say that, but just a masterful job of deconstruction. But he's but not so masterful in constructing an argument. So I was at a lecture that he was giving. I wrote my dissertation on planning, so I went to one of the lectures he was giving. And so he'd gone through all of his discussion on properly based belief and proper based county. And somebody raised a hand in the audience and said, "I'm a pastor. I'm just wondering, how do you, you know, you're talking about theism and how coherent it is. How do you distinguish between Islam and Judaism and Christianity?" And Dr. Punning said, I don't know really on that one. Van Til would say, because without Christianity, nothing else, including your beliefs, can make any sense. Islam can't do it. Judaism can't do it. Only Christianity can do it. Because Christianity tells us that God is Father, Son, Holy Spirit, and is constantly, always, everywhere, in every place, revealing himself to every person all the time, now and into eternity future. That's the truth of the matter. And apologetics seeks to make that truth evident to people so that it connects with the truth that they already know because God has been there revealing himself. Okay, I'll stop there and see if there are questions. Do I have time for questions, Chris?
Absolutely.
Okay. Okay, no questions. Thank you for...
Could you come this way?
Oh.
I was wondering if you'd go a little bit slower through the, I took notes. The basic syllogism of...
All men are mortal, Socrates is a man, therefore Socrates is mortal.
Formally it's been explained that we use induction and probability on the first one, so how do you respond to that?
The point I was trying to make is that that's kind of a standard Aristotelian syllogism that is meant to be not only a valid but a sound argument. And in order for it to be a valid and a sound argument, the premises have to be true. If it's not sound, then you can say if the premises are true, the conclusion follows. But if it's a sound and valid argument, you have to say the premises are true. Now, my point is not that you want to argue that with people, but my point is, how do you know premise one? All right? So in your situation, and this is where a lot of philosophers go when they're confronted with that question, they say, well, it's a high probability. All right, so... All men are probably mortal. Socrates is probably a man. Therefore, probably, Socrates, you're probably mortal. I'm probably mortal. But maybe not. Well, why not? Well, if you're Stephen Hawking, because aliens might come get you, and then you won't, you'll be okay. I mean, they invent all kinds of things. And this is the problem with the evidentialist apologetic. I have a quote from John Warren Montgomery. I didn't use it, but where he talks about the probability of someone finding a body in Christ's tomb, he says, is virtually nil. Virtually nil. So, probably not. Really high probability that he's not in that tomb. Now, you don't do apologetics that way. You don't dare say that to someone who doesn't believe in Christ. You don't have that option as a Christian. So probability really is meaningless in that context. Philosophers have to default there because they recognize they have nowhere to go.
Dr. Oliphint, I just want to say, first of all, even though you weren't the 300th episode guest, I think, on the Reform Forum, I would say you're probably the best one. Well, I enjoy most of the episodes you're on. So.
That's kind of you. Thank you very much. Just for those of you that don't know, Camden Busey runs Reform Forum, and he interviewed me. I don't remember when it was, and I said, I'm kind of hurt that you didn't let me have your 300th episode. I really wanted to be at 300, but I was kind of teasing. So thank you for that.
My question is this, and I don't know if you mentioned this. I did come in a little bit late. As far as Van Til goes, a lot of his students have different perspectives. So what would you say is the one unique characteristic that they would all hold in common, per se, if you can? And then maybe what are some of the distinctives that make them unique as far as each thinker that deters from Van Til? I don't want to say deter, but maybe has their own approach.
Yeah. Well, that's a good question. The thing that is meant to be distinctive about Van Til's approach, and I tell my students this at Westminster, is if your theology is not reformed, you don't have the option to be covenantal in your apologetic approach or presupposition. You don't have that option. So, and you know, many of you don't know about Westminster, but we get people from all over the world, and we do not just train Presbyterians. We graduate more Presbyterians than we bring in, and that's what we want to do. But we bring in people from all kinds of theological persuasions. And I tell them, if your theology is Arminian, you can't use this approach because the approach has to presuppose Reformed theology. And then I say, and you'll become Reformed as the Holy Spirit changes your heart and sanctification. So that's the distinctive. And then there are variations within that distinctive. You know, it's almost impossible for me to do that without getting into personality, so I guess I'd want to stay away from that. But I think you read Van Til for yourself, and then you see if what he says resonates. I'll say this, in my AP 213, my second year apologetics class that all of our students are required to take, they have to read Bonson's Reader as part of their required work. So that's what they read to get Van Til. So I'll leave it there.
In last night's debate, there were two issues that I thought needed a little bit more development. One is that the atheists didn't really understand the difference between a presupposition and an assumption. So that was kind of one of the things that didn't come clear. It would probably have helped the discussion. Number two is that, you know, because of everything that happened, I don't think we ever got to the point about why is it that it's the triune God of the Bible that we posit and that would support our presuppositions, or that it is the God of the triune God of the Bible and his revelation that helps us understand why he alone is the necessary preconditions for making sense of reality. So I would just like to know your distinction between a presupposition and an assumption. And number two, what would be the short list of things that you would say that are specific to the triune God of the Bible as opposed to a generic God that would be posited for this, you know, for this necessary precondition of reality?
Right.
So what would be the short list of things that you would point to about God that would support that? Thanks.
On the first one, there doesn't have to be a big distinction between presupposition and assumption, and that's one of the reasons I just don't like the word. It's too fluid. It's too ambiguous. It's too philosophically loaded. If you're going to use it, I think you've got to use it in the way Van Til did, and that is, it has to do with things that are meant to be a foundation for what we think is true. That is, a foundation is something behind which you cannot go. Where do you stand in order to assert whatever it is you're asserting? All right? That kind of presupposition. And that foundation can be epistemological. That is, it could be your foundation of knowledge, or it could be metaphysical, your foundation in terms of the way reality is. Both of those historically, and this goes all the way back at least to Aristotle, recognizing you've got to have a foundation in order to say anything. That's not just a Vantillian notion. That goes back to Aristotle, and then the Reformed adapted that and understood it. The word that they used was principium, Latin, which means foundation or source. So in that sense, a foundation is not just an assumption, but it's where you stand in order to assert. So back to Hitchens, where do you stand in order to say religion poisons everything, and what's wrong with that? The subtitle was meant to say there's something wrong with poisoning everything. Why is that wrong? On what foundation do you stand to make that moral judgment? Okay, so that's when you're getting at, here's the fact, he thinks, religion poisons everything. What's the presupposition behind that? It can't be some sort of absolute standard of morality. The second thing I would say, In response to your question, it's a good question. The reason a generic theism won't do is because generic theism is idolatry. And that's what I tell my students. If the goal of apologetics is to prove that there is some God somewhere, then I'm out of business. I don't want to be involved. And I don't want to teach anybody that. Because the problem is not theism. The problem is that people don't understand Christian theism. There's only one theism. Every other theism is an idolatry. I'll talk about this on Sunday morning, but Paul had a host of theists in his audience at Athens. What was he trying to do? Make other more theists? You know, here's another god. You can add this one to your pantheon. No. This is idolatry. All right? So the reason you presuppose the Christian triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit is because there is no other, and he alone has spoken. And if you don't believe that, then you got to tell me what you do believe that supports your worldview and your system of thinking. And by the way, you can't use rationalism, you can't use empiricism, you can't use Kant, you can't use Hegel, you can't use positivism. So just outline the history of philosophy. Abysmal failure for 4,000 years, where are you going to go? What are you going to tell me is your foundation? And if you can't find one, I've got one for you. And by the way, you don't always say it this way. I'm just trying to go quickly here. And by the way, the foundation that I'm going to speak to you about, you already know him, but you suppress that in unrighteousness. Now, again, I don't say that a lot of times to people, but you know that's the case when you're speaking the truth to them.
In regard to the 1 second plug that Dr. Oliphint quickly passed by, he will be preaching here at 10 a.m. Sunday morning. So you're all invited to that.
Paul at Athens. Yes, sir.
In relation to Paul at Athens, I guess I should maybe give some background. Over the past 6 years, I've engaged in apologetics and theory and practice on a college campus. I'm a recent graduate from university. And in trying to find the scriptural basis for apologetics, you kind of naturally look for the instances of evangelism in the New Testament. And there, it's caused me to kind of flip back and forth between evidentialism and presuppositionalism. And I'm wondering where in, it's usually Paul, but Peter has an address as well, where in their gospel presentations we can find a justification for presuppositionalism or evidentialism or both. And I know it may make a difference that they were always speaking to theists, be it Jews or pagans. But yeah, just where in their words can we find some direction as far as this debate goes?
Right. Okay, part of me wants to say Sunday morning I'll try to address that because I'm going to preach on Paul at Athens. But I think the question, I'm going to have to rephrase the question. In what way does your theology require you to use a certain apologetic method, and what apologetic method does your theology require? See, what I'm trying to say is I'm not looking for a passage that I can pull out and say, now, that's presuppositional. I think it's obviously supported by Reformed theology, and Reformed theology, it works up from biblical revelations, exegetically based, and I'll mention some of that in the discussion that Paul has at Athens. I'll talk about that, and I'll show how he's being covenantal and presuppositional in the way that he approaches that. But as I was also trying to say, that's not in any way opposed to using evidence at all. It's just a matter of who's interpreting the evidence and how we're meant to understand the evidence. So try to get rid of the dichotomy in your mind and recognize that a truly Reformed approach, covenantal presupposition, that kind of approach has its roots and foundation in Reformed theology. And if you're Reformed in your theology, that's the approach you've got to use. If you're not Reformed in your theology, then we need to talk theology before we talk apologetics. And we'll get you there.
This will be our last question for Dr. Oliphint. I did hear a rumor that some people need food, not just theology. So we will have a one-hour break after this question, and we'll see you back here to hear from Dr. Rushdoony and Dr. McDermott.
I liked your slide on Van Til's use of knowledge. And reading through Robert Raymond's Systematic Theology, he deals with that issue.
Yes.
And his presentation seemed a little different, so that's why I appreciated yours. So is he addressing more of maybe how Aquinas viewed it, maybe not Van Til having a chance to fully articulate his view? Because it seems as though he was saying both Aquinas and Van Til kind of were saying God's knowledge is different in ours in that it could mean two totally different things.
Right, yeah. See, there's just so much to say on this. In the discussion, all right, let me just say it this way. You know, you got the other side, so I'm going to give you my side. Clark and Raymond and those that follow him do not understand the Reformed tradition epistemologically. They just don't get it. So they're going to other dictionaries and philosophical ways of understanding analogical predication versus univocal predication, and that's not a part of the theological debate. What is a part of the theological debate is how do we understand the creator-creature distinction? This is what Thomas was trying to get at. I mean, Thomas was, as far as I can tell, a good Christian. He just had some pretty serious issues in his prolegomena. But he's trying to get at the relationship of creator and creature, and he's saying it's got to be analogical. He's right about that, but he didn't have a way to construe it because he had too much philosophy in his brain. There was too much Aristotle and not enough Paul. And I think that's the problem with Clark and with Raymond. I was at a conference years ago where someone was presenting a paper on logic and how that relates to God, and a man was there whom you would know, who's one of Clark's primary disciples, and he raised his hand. He said, "Don't you think," and he was dead serious, he said, "don't you think God is an Aristotelian?" Now, I think that ought to tell us a good bit about what the problem is when you begin to have logic and project it into the mind of God. Van Til says logic is a created expression of the coherence of the nature of God. That's a very good way to put it. It's a created expression. We can't do without it. We all use it. Absolutely true. But unless you understand it as a created expression, therefore having its limits and its boundaries, then your only option is to project it into the mind of God. And then God becomes, well, what did Clark say? In the beginning was logic, and logic was with God, and logic was God. No. No, absolutely no, not for a Reformed Christian. And that's why the Reformed, the Thomistic Reformed, when they became Reformed, said, we can't have the univocity, we cannot have the univocal epistemology anymore. It has to be revelationally based, and that means it presupposes God speaking the truth from his archetypal to ectypal to our archetypal, the truth into creation. All right, so that's a quick and...
Thank you so much, Doctor.
Thank you.